Hello and welcome, everyone. We are now live from Montreal and Toronto, Canada. Hello to all the teachers, students, administrators, community groups, cadets, and anyone else out there watching. Thank you for joining us today for something very special, an inside look at the temporary exhibition, Great Women During the War, 1939 to 1945, which is housed at the world-class Juno Beach Centre located in Courseulles-sur-Mer, France. This exhibition was developed by the Juno Beach Centre in partnership with the Canadian War Museum in Ottawa. My name is Megan Barrington. My pronouns are she, her, and I am based in EF Tours Toronto office, and I'll be your host today. There's power in sharing multiple perspectives of history, which help us contextualize the experiences of those who served. There were countless valuable contributions from diverse demographics that participated in all aspects of the war effort, and their stories are beginning to be shared more and more. We're so grateful for our expanding knowledge and understanding of veterans' experiences. An additional way to show our appreciation, specifically for the Indigenous, Métis, and Inuit veterans, is by mindfully and gratefully acknowledging the land we're on today. I'd like to mindfully and gratefully acknowledge that EF's Toronto office is on land covered by Treaty 13 with the Mississaugas of the Credit, and that Toronto is the traditional land of many nations, including the Mississaugas of the Credit, the Anishinaabeg, the Chippewa, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat peoples, and is now home to many diverse First Nations, Inuit, and Métis peoples. Though the history textbooks we've grown up with may have excluded or undermined certain contributions, their truths are increasingly being revealed to us, which makes exhibits like Great Women During the War necessary, and why we're so thrilled to bring it to all of you across Canada today. We are lucky to be joined by several members of the Juno Beach Centre staff who are here to facilitate an amazing session today, all focused on the incredible contribution of women during the war. This event can't really compare to what you'd see and experience in person, but we hope that it inspires you to learn more about Canada's role in the Second World War, honor the women that led the way during this moment in history, and that one day soon, plan to visit the Juno Beach Centre in person. Before we introduce our panelists, let me first share some quick tips about the platform we are using today. You will notice that your cameras are automatically turned off and your microphones are muted. You will not be able to unmute yourself or turn your camera on. You'll notice both a chat and a Q&A button at the bottom of your screens. Please feel free to use the chat box at any time. Introduce yourselves, tell us where you're from, let us know how many of you are watching, and you can just have a chat. If you have any questions for our friends at the JBC, or the Juno Beach Centre, I should say, at any time, please type them into the Q&A box. You can also let us know if you'd like to ask your questions live. All questions about the exhibit, the videos we're going to share, the history of women during the Great War are welcome. And we'll answer as many of them as we have time to at the end. We want to make sure that as many students as possible across Canada can see today's event. So we will be recording it and emailing it out to all of you in the coming days. Now, let's meet our panelists. Today, we are joined by Alex Fitzgerald Black from the Juno Beach Centre Association based in Ontario. And next, we have Marie-Ève Vaillancourt, also from the JBCA, joining us from Montreal. Helping out today is Chelsea Smith, hi, based in EF's Toronto office, who will be working behind the scenes, monitoring the chat and the Q&A box. Okay, without further ado, I'm going to pass it over to our colleague, Marie-Ève, who's going to start by setting the scene for the event today. Remember, you'll have the chance to ask any questions you might have at the end. So if things come to mind, pop them in the Q&A box. Hi, Marie-Ève.
Hello, everyone. So yes, my name is Marie-Ève Vaillancourt, and I'm the Director of Exhibitions at the Juno Beach Centre. So I'm thrilled to be here today to give you a glimpse of our Great Women of the War exhibition. The exhibition is located at the centre in France, and I should say a few words about the Juno Beach Centre itself before we start. So it's located in a very special place right on Juno Beach, which is one of the five landing beaches used where the Allies landed in 1944 after 5 years of war. So we're going to be talking about some notions in the exhibition that probably can be explained a little bit as we talk about these women. So I'll set up the context for each of them. And the Juno Beach Centre, as I said, it's located in France. It welcomes a lot of European visitors, mostly European visitors, and of course, some Canadians, including Canada's youth that we're really proud to welcome through EF each year. And it's not just a museum about D-Day, which is a one-day operation of the whole war. It's Canada's second World War Memorial overseas in Europe. So our exhibitions cover the whole war years, and it's meant to be a permanent memorial to those who served and the civilian population. And we even cover themes of contemporary Canada in the museum as well. So we try to be a very different museum, a truly Canadian establishment overseas in France, right on the beach where Canadians landed. So as an institution that keeps in mind that we have a lot of European visitors, we develop partnerships, and the Great Women exhibition was prepared with the Canadian War Museum, as Megan said, back in 2019 already, and it's going to close soon in December of 2021. And it's a show that presents 16 different women and their life stories during the Second World War. So we started out by researching 50 different women, and we had the really difficult task of turning it down to something that would feature 16 women. It was really, really hard. And one of the things that we did is that for our European audience, we added some European women to make sure that the contrast and what happened to them was vastly different than the Canadian women. And we were pretty concerned with the fact that even in this day, and back in 2019, there was little done about women's role, women's contribution, and especially sacrifices. So that's what we set out to do back then with the Canadian War Museum. So I'll show you the four themes of the exhibition. Basically, we, in doing the research, we discovered that what was common, whether you were European or French or Canadian as a woman in the Second World War, there were some underlying universal themes which related to fear, anxiety, and a lot of pride, actually. So the exhibition is divided in four themes, making a difference. So that's all the unpaid labor and the volunteering that's done that often goes unnoticed and unrecognized. The second one was those who served and wore the uniform for the first time to replace men to go to the front. And then the civilian workforce was the war industries that were mobilized to win the Second World War in Canada, all the women who entered the workforce for the first time and what that did for them in our general society after the war. And then, of course, worry and loss. We talk about a lot about women who are the wives, the mothers, the sisters, the fiancés of those who served, and what sacrifices and grieving that they had to go through during the Second World War, which is also difficult to establish. So in light of Remembrance Day that's coming up tomorrow, this will give you a lot of food for thought. And sometimes we remember the veterans, and they're mostly male in uniform, but we have to remember the unnoticed women's contributions. So I'll begin to show you the exhibition, but we are lucky enough to bring you the women that we wanted to talk about with you today are brought to you by the guides at the Juno Beach Centre. So I'll show you quickly what that is. It's a really cool job that some of you might want to consider if you're bilingual when you're in university. We hire each year a team of 8 to 10 guides, and they come and stay at Courseulles-sur-Mer for a period of 8 months. And so far, we've had about 150 young Canadians who have worked with us at the center. And we often like to say that we hire them to become miniature or sort of micro ambassadors to Canada, to represent Canada overseas, but their experience, given that it's so long, they come back almost like miniature ambassadors to France. And one of the reasons why we hire young Canadian guides in their years beginning at university is that the founders of the Juno Beach Centre were veterans of D-Day themselves, and they wanted to be represented by Canada's youth because the guides are usually the same age as most of the men landed on D-Day in 1944. All right. So the first vignette that's going to be brought to you is through Isabella, who's from Ottawa, Ontario. And she's studying at the University of Ottawa. She's going to be sharing the story of Molly Lamb Boback, who was a Canadian war artist during the Second World War. So, okay, what's a Canadian war artist? Basically, Canada established a program that was comprised of 42 artists to depict the experiences of those who served in the Second World War, whether they were serving at home or abroad on the different fronts in Italy and Normandy and the Netherlands and Germany. And 26 of them were sent overseas. And part of this cohort included only one woman. It was Molly, and she was sent over to the Netherlands after Victory in Europe Day, which was in May 1945. And her role was to depict through her art, through her own style, and through her paintings, what women were doing in the Netherlands, those who were serving in uniform. So they were doing clerical work, they were doing post office work, laundry, cooking, and mostly clerical duties to relieve men to go fight at the front. And she was tasked to represent basically the roles of about 50,000 Canadian women who joined the forces, whether it was the Army, the Navy, or the Royal Canadian Air Force. And so without further ado, I will let Isabella start her presentation about Molly.
Molly Lamb Boback is a Canadian artist who played a crucial role in captivating war art throughout the Second World War. Boback was born in Vancouver, BC, shortly after the First World War, to a family that was very involved in the art community. Her father was the highly acclaimed photographer Harold Mortimer Lamb, and her family was very close to the Group of Seven painter A.Y. Jackson. Prior to the war, Boback trained at the Vancouver School of Art, and afterwards she signed up for the Canadian Women's Army Corps in 1942. She had the goal of becoming a war artist, but prior to Boback, no woman had ever held the role. Afterwards, after lobbying for 2 years within the Canadian Women's Army Corps, she received the role of war artist in Canada. Boback's paintings throughout the Second World War are extremely important because she painted the perspective of women's experiences during the war, and many of her paintings demonstrated a critique of gender within the forces. Most of her paintings are central to the experience of women during basic training and service women performing various tasks that are often overlooked but are crucial to the war effort. Her paintings included kitchens, garages, laundries, and offices. Not only did these paintings capture the lives of servicewomen, but it also later established Boback as a professional artist after the war. She is now one of Canada's most celebrated artists.
Great, okay. So the second woman we choose to present to you today is Marianne Gold Goslas, and she's from Europe. So she was of Austrian citizenship, but she had moved to Czechoslovakia and Prague precisely during the war because she had married a Jewish man. Her story, as Ariane from Ottawa will be telling us, is that of extreme bravery and courage during the Second World War. So as some of you might know, during the Second World War, all of Europe, of Western Europe and parts of Eastern Europe, was occupied by the Nazis, by Nazi Germany. So the occupation meant that basically people lived under the rule of Nazi Germany. It meant that each country was at the mercy, basically, of the Nazis. It meant food rationing. It meant also a lot of persecution of the Jews. The Nazis were after finding and interning and putting Jews in concentration camps and death camps, basically. So there was a lot of anti-Semitism in Europe during the Second World War. And a lot of people took it upon themselves quite bravely to try to save from certain death Jewish families, Jewish children. And Marianne was one of these women who consciously chose to make a difference in trying to save Jews from persecution and extermination, basically. And she knew fully that by committing to these actions, she could really risk losing her own life. So because she was married to a Jewish man, she made sure that her husband could escape to England. And then she set out to establish some networks to smuggle Jewish children and families back to safety in England. This was highly illegal. And I'm going to let Ariane tell you the rest of her story. She's one brave woman that we were so happy to highlight her contributions.
So here we have a section of the exhibition on Marianne Goldlust. She was actually a prominent Austrian singer before the war even erupted, traveling all around Eastern Europe and singing in wonderful opera houses and such. But as her career progressed, she herself took a career change and became a theater critique. And it's as she changed careers and began really indulging in that part of her life that she met Hans Goldlust, who would then become her husband. Hans Goldlust, we have to say, was a Jewish journalist. And so together they lived in Czechoslovakia, which in 1938 fell under German hands, and with that as well, Nazi occupation. And as a result of that, Hans was actually arrested. Now, fortunately, Marianne had a lot of wonderful connections she had built up through her career as an opera singer and was able to get him out of prison. But for Hans and his family, this was a wake-up call, and so they exiled themselves to England slightly before the war and even during the war to protect themselves from this Jewish anti-Semitic harassment. Fortunately, due to her connections as an opera singer, Marianne was able to release Hans from prison. However, for Hans and his family, this was a wake-up call, and so they made the decision to exile themselves from Czechoslovakia to England for the duration of the war in light of rising anti-Semitic regulations. Marianne had the decision to whether or not she wanted to follow that family to England for her own security, and actually chose to stay to participate in the resistance and as well to help Jews as well escape Nazi occupation and anti-Semitic regulation, especially during the war. Now, she was able to continue these resistance activities for quite some time, but in 1943, there was a mole in her unit that betrayed the resistance group. Again, here, Marianne was able to make use of her connections to free her colleagues with whom she had done resistance activities. However, she was not able to free herself from prison. And while from the outside her family tried best they could to free her, ultimately she faced the death penalty and she could not escape it. And so on the 8th of October, 1943, Marianne was executed. Here we have a wonderful example of the cost of resistance, but as well of its necessity. Because while she may have lost her life in the process, Marianne succeeded in saving many Jewish lives.
Okay, so the next presentation will be from Abigail, who's from London, Ontario, and is studying history at the University of Ottawa. And she will tell us the story of an amazingly brave Canadian woman, Sonia D'Artois, who was a member of Special Operations Executive, or the SOE. It was a British secret organization during the Second World War. So basically, this group was training in Britain, and the idea was to create spies that would be dropped by parachute behind enemy lines before D-Day. Now, just a few words about D-Day. I've been using that expression. Just want to make it clear. As I said before, the Juno Beach Centre is located on Juno Beach where Canadians landed. That's just one of the five beaches that form a front of 180-kilometer shoreline where the Allies, the British, the Americans, and the Canadians, and a lot of other nationalities, were coming together to commence and begin the liberation from occupied Europe. So the war had begun in 1939, but it took the Allies 5 years to be ready for that one-day operation. It's still up to this day the largest amphibious landing in the history of the world, where 150,000 men stormed these beaches to destroy the German defenses and commence the liberation and pushing the German armies all the way back to Berlin and Germany. We eventually succeeded in that, which led to the end of the Second World War. But before D-Day, it was really important that there were a number of active spies dropped behind enemy line. Most of them were men, but about a handful of them were women, including Sonia. So she landed a few days before D-Day, and she was active behind enemy lines during the whole of the Normandy campaign. And Abigail will be telling you a little bit about what she did. She was helping basically resistance networks, and she was in charge of training French resistance men to become part of the resistance. And the whole idea was that they would set up explosives and sabotage railway stations, railway lines, and make sure that more German reinforcements could not reach that famous coast where the Allies were landing. It was really important undercover work, extremely risky, of course. And I'll let Abigail tell the rest of the story of Sonia, who's a true Canadian hero that not enough people know about.
Sonia Butt, later Sonia d'Artois, was a spy for the British Special Operations Executive, otherwise known as the SOE, in the Second World War. She was only 19 years old when she parachuted behind enemy lines 9 days before the D-Day landings in Normandy. She knew that her mission was very dangerous and that she may not even land when she jumped from the plane. She did, however, successfully land near Le Mans, but her descent didn't go as planned. She hurt her back and shoulder on the landing, and her pack was dropped on a highway and recovered by a German patrol. This alerted the Germans that there was a female agent in their midst and forced Sonia to adopt her plans. Instead of going into hiding as the Germans would expect, she worked in plain sight, circulating amongst French civilians to recruit and train fighters and weapons and explosives. They could not gather large groups of Maquis resistance groups, so they divided them into smaller groups and hosted meetings to plan missions. While on her way to attend one of these meetings, Sonia described getting a sixth sense that told her not to go. She decided to follow her gut, and thankfully so, as she later learned that there was a double agent in their midst who reported the group to the German Gestapo. This shows that being an agent at this time was always a life-threatening situation. When the Allies landed on June 6, 1944, Sonia and her fellow agents started working for the Americans, going behind enemy lines as they liberated various French towns. They decided that if they were caught, their cover would be that they were collaborators and had been pursued by the resistance. After the war ended, Sonia married fellow agent Guy d'Artois, a Canadian who also participated in undercover operations. The two settled in Montreal, Quebec, and they were married for 55 years and had 6 children. Speaking of the transition to civilian life, Sonia later joked that she went from mixing explosives to baby formula. Sonia's incredible story illustrates the bravery of women in the Second World War who defy both gender norms and life-threatening situations to serve the greater good and liberate Europeans from oppression. Although hers is certainly an extraordinary case, women all around the world seized the opportunity during the Second World War to better the lives of others and push gender equality forward in hopes that future generations could live in a better world.
All right, so just keep in mind that these were just 3 women that we have the time today to present to you, but that there were another good half dozen profiles that we wish we could have shared with you today. It's really an incredibly wonderful experience to be part of making a show that recognizes some things that have never really been talked about. I hope that you can discover more of the exhibition in the section that we have on our website about it. Now, I wanted to touch upon the notion of women in the workplace just in Canada during the Second World War. So very much prior to the Second World War, women's place were just strictly in the home, meant to marry, to have children and raise families. And at the beginning of the war, there was a shortage of men in the workplace. So it started out really gradually where women were allowed to enter the workforce to replace the men who were gone fighting or training. And they ended up working in war industries. Gradually, mothers were allowed to join the workforce. And then eventually women of color, which was the first in Canada. Now, something that we take for granted today are daycares, which actually have their roots back in the Second World War as wartime nurseries that were set up in 1942. And it was very much that at the end of the Second World War, women who were in the workforce had to go back to their homes. It was the message sent to them. It was really even seen as unpatriotic to keep a job that another man could take up, especially returning soldiers from the front. The veterans who came back home needed their jobs back. So women were kindly asked to leave the scene of the workforce. And so in 1946, these wartime nurseries or daycare entirely stopped. It wouldn't be brought back, as we know, pretty much probably all of you have attended a daycare. And it's kind of interesting to know that the beginnings of that in Canada are stemmed from the Second World War experience. It would take another 20 years in Canada before the numbers of women employed in the workforce would return to the wartime levels. That was in 1966. So it's been a really great legacy that women put in place during the Second World War that's usually not discussed very much. It was a first. Now, in the First World War, women entered the workforce and were again asked to leave. So the changes that they paved the way for were enormous in our Canadian society. So I'm going to let now Alex speak to another woman that we want to present to you today. And I hope that these few portraits that we've brushed up for you have allowed you to consider how to remember tomorrow during your November 11th ceremonies and the women that comprised this incredible war effort that Canada was mobilized for during the Second World War.
Thank you, Mary Ev, for leading our discussion there at the start here and for curating the exhibition itself. Hi, everybody. My name is Alex Fitzgerald Black, and I'm the executive director at the Juno Beach Centre Association. It's my pleasure today to introduce one of our exciting programs. So the Juno Beach Centre is compiling a collection of Legacy of Honour videos. In each short video, a veteran shares their story of service. And soon we will no longer be able to capture veterans' voices and experiences. And so it's important to gather and share these testimonies while we still can. There are actually, in fact, maybe fewer than 20,000 Canadian Second World War veterans left today. And that's out of over 1 million who served. The Juno Beach Centre Museum has been built to tell the story of Canadians at war and to preserve their legacy for future generations. So each Legacy of Honour video has been created in direct pursuit of that mission. There are 19 videos in the series, and they can be seen on our website, with more in the planning stages, but held up by the pandemic. So the video you're about to see today features Jay Edwards, and I'll just give you a little bit of context about her story. So she was a British citizen living in Britain at the outbreak of the Second World War, and she joined the Air Transport Auxiliary early in the war. Now, this was a civilian organization that supported the Royal Air Force by transporting aircraft between airfields or from the factories to the airfields so that the pilots and air crews and the ground crews could make use of them. It could be dangerous work, as during certain times during the war, Britain's skies were contested by the German Air Force. Interestingly, she would not have been traditionally considered a veteran, as she did not serve in the military, although she did serve in a role that the military itself facilitated overseas. She is 103 years old this past October and presently lives in British Columbia. And she is just one of two surviving women ATA pilots out of the 166 who serve. And with that, I'll turn it over to the video and to Jay's voice.
My name is Jay Edwards. I use this name during the war. And most of my life, I've been called Pete. Our surname was Peterson. I was a member of the Air Transport Auxiliary after I had served nursing in the WAF, and then moved into ATA, which is Air Transport Auxiliary, where we flew planes for the RAF, but were civilian pilots. I grew to 5'11", a good 5'11", but never actually hit six. and my parents were just about the same height. I flew the first time in April of 1939. I had read in the newspaper about a National Women's Air Reserve. It met on Sundays so that girls working in stores and offices would be able, from London would be able to come. We met in Luton, which is just north of London. We wore white boiler suits and were given information about the makeup of planes and how they flew. So I started flying lessons. At the time, UK government realized that they were going to need a lot of young people, well, particularly boys, but they included the girls to fly planes during the war. And ATA, when it was formed in early 1939, and they were formed to use this opportunity of getting cheap flying. And it was five shillings an hour weekdays and 10 shillings an hour on the weekends. That way, I, as a person not working outside, was able to start earlier. My mother was paying. I had said to her, what would you say if I was going to fly, learn to fly? She said, we'll have to think about that. So I said, that's okay, I'll just wait till I'm 21. That's in 6 months. When you were called, you were called to go to TAME, and there they had an airfield, grass airfield, and they checked you out to see what you had done previously. There were some of us had flown, as I had, with 2 hours solo. Some had never been on a plane. We'd finished that course and done cross countries to prove you could fly without any communication with the ground and no names on maps. You went, when you were given what they called a chit, you would fly, go to the Met and ask about the weather and also ask where this place was, because it was written on the chit, but it wasn't on the map. And they would put a pin and point, this is where you're going. Yes, a prang is when you hit the ground. I was about 50 yards off the fence, and the boys were working in a shack close by. I was being very conscientious. I was looking over my left shoulder and being sure that everything was fine, nothing here, forgetting completely about the right. And all of a sudden, crunch, I'd hit a tree. I don't know what happened to the tree, but I put my hand out, I can see it now, I put my hand out to make sure the gas was turned off. The rod was broken. It couldn't feed any gas, so there was no possibility of fire. But the guys were out of their shack and over to me and said, we don't have to cannibalize a plane, you've done it for us. So they were not unhappy. And they picked me up with an ambulance and took me to hospital. And I had to say to them, my sister's a theater sister, please let her know. Because I didn't want her to come be getting the hospital, the operating room ready, because I knew I was going to have to go in. I'd lost my teeth. They were left in the crash pad. Well, I could have done much more harm. I was lucky. But yes, I did have a second prime. I landed, and I thought I'd landed with my wheels going up. It was a Spitfire that way. But they told me no, it landed with drift on it. So, but we didn't get to see it. You know, they didn't take you to see it. So you had to take their word for it. I mean, some of the things I did during the war were quite positive to me and negative to really being in war. The Spitfire was even, it wasn't the best in the world, but it was the best in what it did. It could maneuver more quickly and efficiently than any plane. In 44, when they were desperate for planes in Malta, there was an aircraft carrier, and we had to get planes over into Northern Ireland. And the planes were in Yeovilton. The older pilots could take the direct route or get themselves the way they wanted. The juniors had to go into Scotland to the first spot that sort of was a slight bulge out towards Ireland and fly the shortest distance across the ocean or the North Sea to get to Ireland and then go to Belfast and land. And the second you were down and in the parking lot, there was a naval chappie who jumped on your wing, pressed the button so the wings went up. Were you navigated by the seat of your pants? You had the map. That was it. Well, I was on a training session, and the instructor was going to show me a stall turn in which you go almost vertical and then turn very sharply sideways. And she did this, and my stomach said, no way. And I was very sick. She was sitting behind me. We landed very promptly. She landed very promptly. She had to clean up. Yes, that was quite, but I never, because of that, knowing that ATA demanded that you take a plane and land it where it was of some use and in good shape, I never attempted aerobatics myself. You have to laugh. You have to have a laugh in life. The opportunity was there, I took it. I think if you look at my limerick, they sort of put that thought in the limerick, that I did what I wanted. There weren't so many chances in my generation to do things that were unusual.
There we go. Make sure my video's back up here. So we've just heard stories about women from a variety of backgrounds and cultures today. And there are even more diverse stories for us to discover. And it's important to hear different voices from this period. The Second World War is the last lengthy world event that had such a profound impact on Canadian society as COVID-19 is having today. The veterans fought three terrible regimes, especially Nazi Germany. The world would be very different today if the Germans had won. Victory made the world safe for democracy, and it also gave us a chance to build a better Canada and a better world. The fates of millions in Europe also changed, and we talked about that with some of the women who were involved in the European campaign. And Canadians liberated populations in Italy and France and Belgium and the Netherlands. And perhaps we could say they liberated the Germans as well. Those who experienced the war, whether they were veterans or other Canadians, went on to build the modern Canada that we inherit today. We must also include different voices and different perspectives in our understanding of Canadian war history. we generally tend to, and you have to start with the grand narrative, you have to start with the big story, the overall context, but there was no single personal experience that can represent Canada at war. 1.1 million Canadians served, and tens of thousands of others, women in particular, worked in war industries or in war-related service. Those who served in the armed forces also had different experience based on their branch of service, where they were assigned, and on their experiences in combat or non-combat roles. These events also had huge impacts on civilians, like those in the combat zone or the families of service members back in Canada. We can't forget their experiences as well. At the time, during the Second World War, a person's sex, race, religion, or even sexual orientation could and often did impact their experience, either during the war or when they came home to live their lives. You know, Mariev was talking about how women in many cases had to leave the workforce after the Second World War. Black Canadians or Indigenous Canadians were not always welcome at local legions to reminisce and share their stories about the war. It's quite strange because, of course, during the war, when they were in those frontline units, they were actually treated pretty well. It was all about, you know, could you do the job and not, you know, what was your background? And unfortunately, Canada still had to catch up to that mindset overall. Finally, engagement is an important element as to why we need to share different perspectives. Stories need to resonate with their audience, and often the audience wants to see a piece of itself in those stories. And so as Canada, you know, we increasingly have populations who originate from outside the country or who are first generation, second generation immigrants. There are plenty of opportunities to integrate their stories into the way we tell our story of the Second World War in Canada. Canadians served alongside, many different countries, Poles in Normandy, Indians in Italy, for instance. And those are just some of the examples we can turn to. And so with that, I'll hand things back to our hosts.
Hello, everyone. This is Chelsea from the EF team in Toronto. Wow, I think I speak for everyone when I say those stories were incredible, so impactful. And thank you so much to all of our contributors for sharing those stories with us today. We are now moving into the Q&A, the question and answer portion of our webinar. So classes who are joining us, feel free to take a few moments and think of whether you have any questions that you would like to try and enter into the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. We do have about 10 minutes, so we're going to try and get to as many questions as we can. Maybe I can ask one that popped up in the chat just to get us going. And this maybe is a question for Marie-Ève. The question is, other than working in factories, how else did women contribute to the war effort at home?
I'm gonna unmute myself. Basically, women were really mobilized in all activities that related to charity work and raising funds, raising money. So essentially, that meant being behind some of the large drives for the purchase of victory bonds in the Second World War. So this was a program which civilians were asked to purchase, like almost like a gift card to the Canadian government to really fund and make sure that our war effort was as great as it could be. Of course, we were a major ally, especially to Britain in the early hours of the war. So those contributions, raising millions of dollars in victory bonds worth, was primarily done by women. And I believe the figure in today's context would be like around 250 million Canadian dollars that women raised. And this is unrecognized, unnoticeable. I myself did not even know that women were behind some of these victory bonds during the Second World War. I see a comment too coming up. We featured a woman too in the exhibition that we didn't talk about today, whose first job was working on the farms. And a lot of teenagers actually went up and began to work on different farms so that we would bring a food supply line to Britain, who was basically surrounded by the enemy during the Second World War. I mean, they were bombarded. They were never invaded by Nazi Germany, but they came to a few close calls. And so those industries in Canada completely adapted to hiring and employing teenagers. And for volunteer work, it was children who worked on the farms. So yeah, the charity work, we did a lot of research for our upcoming exhibition on Dieppe. A lot of women were in associations of prisoners of war relatives. So they tried to provide through the Red Cross often some packages that were sent to the prisoners of war in Germany. Our Canadian soldiers who participated in the Dieppe raid, the vast majority of them became POWs, and they spent a bunch of Christmases away from home. So the care packages that were sent to them was like the last lifeline that they had to their home during the Second World War. Now, the Red Cross packages were also often full of knitted items that a lot of women knitted during the Second World War. It was a popular activity to do. Even the co-founder of the Juno Beach Centre, who was a teenager during the Second World War, Lise Cooper, she knitted, and she recalls that the wool that was supplied was of low quality and it hurt their fingers, but they knitted items like socks and toques and neck warmers that were sent over to the soldiers, not just the prisoners of war, of course, but those who were fighting on the front. We have to remember back then, there's no instant communication. So a letter from home would take up to a couple of months, at least a few weeks. And whatever the soldiers could get from home in packages meant the whole world to them. And women were behind that incredible effort that goes unnoticed often.
Thank you so much, Mariev. That was really informative and I hope answers the question. We've got another one, which I think, Mariev, would be great for you to answer. Where do you start when brainstorming or planning a temporary exhibition, or I suppose a longer-term exhibition at the Juno Beach Centre? Could you talk to us a little bit about your process?
Yes, of course. It's a really creative process where the first thing that you have in mind are your visitors and what you want to accomplish with them. So you want to create an experience, you want to create something that's immersive and that's going to really engage the audience, whether they're Canadian or European. And it's quite a challenge to face that sort of double audience, if I could call it that. But we want to think about hitting the audience at different levels. So you have to be really creative in finding ways to tell the story through a different lens. So it could be biographies, it can be objects, it can be photographs from the Second World War, it can be artifacts. And at the Juno Beach Centre, we tend to favor personal stories and we try to lay a mosaic of them. And so in selecting different stories, we often work with the families of those who experienced the war, and it's an incredible opportunity to meet the families who are so proud of their relatives. It's often their fathers or grandfathers, and in some cases, the great grandchildren of those who serve help us make an exhibition. Right now, I'm making an exhibition on Dieppe, and I'm in touch with a great great grandson who's extremely proud of his great-grandfather. And it's kind of curious because the story is incredible, but it skipped a few generations. And because of the interest of the great-grandson, the story comes alive again. So you're often surprised as to who you're going to work with and who's going to bring the stories. But the pride is incredible in the families in Canada today. And we're thankful to work with such people. It's such an honor to be privy to these personal lives.
Thank you so much, Mariev. Alex, I'm going to turn to you now. We've had a question come in, and it is, can you comment on the contributions of POC women during the war times?
Yeah, absolutely. So POC, people of color. It depended on which service you were joining. Some services were more open to people of color than others. Generally speaking, the Navy was the most restrictive, the Air Force perhaps the second most, and the Army the least restrictive. For women, I think the military has often made a big deal of indigenous service, whether it's, you know, from the Second World War, the First World War, or before. And so I can't remember her name, but one of the first indigenous women to serve in the Canadian Armed Forces served during the Second World War as a Canadian, a CWAC, as a Canadian Women's Army Corps servicewoman. And when she joined, they actually did a bit of a campaign around her, a PR campaign, to focus on Indigenous service and to kind of encourage people, to join up. And they actually took some photographs of her kind of standing next to someone who was dressed up as a chief. It was not actually her chief or anything like that. So a little bit of, relatively friendly manipulation going on there. And certainly there were Black women who served in the Canadian Women's Army Corps, and also Chinese women as well. There's actually one of Molly Lamb Bobak's images, I think that you might have seen in the video there, actually depicts a Black Canadian Women's Army Corps servicewoman going about her duties over in the Netherlands, I think it was. So women of color certainly served in the armed forces, and depending on their experiences, they're not necessarily women of color, but for instance, Jewish service women also had somewhat different experiences than perhaps their Christian counterparts, just because they had to make do with a military that was a Christian military and had Christian traditions. And so at the start of the war, they didn't always have accommodations for them in terms of the right types of, kosher foods. And in terms of, the Jewish people, they take their day of rest on Saturday, not Sunday. And the army, typically does things, they take the day of rest on Sunday. And so there's little things like that over the course of the war were ironed out, depending on where they served and what they experienced.
Yes, thank you. I might add very quickly that I visited the grave of a Chinese airman in Normandy a couple of years ago, and he was shot down during an operation during the summer of 1944. And his parents were given the option to write an epitaph, like to write a note on his tombstone, noted that it was quite different. They said his soul is Chinese, but his heart is Canadian.
Thank you so much, Alex and Mariev. I think we have time for one more question, maybe two, depending. But Alex, you actually answered this in the Q&A box, but just in case people didn't see it, the question that came through was, on average, how many different types of aircraft were women in ATA trained to fly?
Yeah, I answered this fairly simply in the chat, but so effectively, if you were an airman, a male serviceman trained to fly in the Second World War, you'd typically fly two or three different aircraft during the course of your training in Canada, and then you'd go overseas and you'd start to train on types that are close to, if you're going into bombers or if you're going into fighters. And so eventually you'd actually train on like a Spitfire if you were eventually going into Spitfires. And then generally speaking, unless you did multiple tours, you'd stick with that aircraft for the bulk of the war. Jay and the ATA, their situation was different. They were required to fly a variety of aircraft, regardless of, what squadrons they were supplying or anything like that. So she herself flew about 20 different aircraft during the course of the war, including the Spitfire that she was talking about during the video.
Wonderful. With that, I think we have time for one more. And this is a question that is more about what it's like to visit the Juno Beach Centre in person. What can you see there? Mariev or Alex, would you like to answer that one?
I'll let you go ahead, Mariev.
Okay, sure. Yes. The Juno Beach Center is not that big, actually, for a national museum. It's about 650 square meters, and it's located right on the beach. Our offices have the great, amazing view on Juno Beach. It's a wonderful place to be. And what you really notice right away from the building structure and features is that it's really truly Canadian. It's very humble. It was designed by an architect who really wanted to make sure that it would not be like super big and super imposing, that it would fit within the community and fit within the landscape around Juno Beach, which is a beautiful beach. You'll be surprised to see a lot of vacationers and a lot of happy families going to the beach with, like, the kids have their shovels and their picks and they build sand castles. And there's a lot of promeneurs who stroll along happily. So it's kind of strange at first as a Canadian when you walk there and you're in a space kind of like Vimy Ridge, you know, of reverence and sobriety, and you're kind of in awe that you're actually standing on Juno Beach and you see all kinds of happy people around you. But most Canadians come to the conclusion that that was pretty much why we fight there.
Yeah, it's always lovely to see, you know, French citizens going about their lives, right? Because that's what it was all for. That's what Miriam's getting at there. And it's also quite the experience. Juno Beach Centre is obviously its museum, but outside the museum, we also provide guided tours of Juno Park. And so, you know, you can actually go and see some of the German bunkers that are still there, and understand the stories behind that. And there's actually some really neat stories the guides tell about sabotage that was going on, you know, behind the Germans' backs. And it kind of really gets you to sit there and really consider, wow, this is what, you know, our you know, it was men, the men who attacked Juno Beach did, you know, 77 years ago, and what they had to surmount in order to be successful and victorious on that day.
Thank you so much, Alex. Thank you, Mariev, and thank you so much to everyone for your great questions. I'm going to pass it back over now to my colleague, Megan.
Wow, what an amazing session. Thank you all for joining. Thank you so much for sharing this history with us, Alex and Mariev. These stories were incredible. We're so glad that Jay was able to share her story with us. And I know we're all thinking about this truth that we have to face, that lived experiences are now being made into recorded memories and stories for us. We hope that this virtual event today has inspired you to reflect on the role of women in the war and how their efforts changed the world for all women. You know, our world has certainly changed drastically, but the significance of Juno Beach remains. I really do hope that each of you watching will one day get the chance to travel to France and visit the Juno Beach Center for yourselves so that you too can feel the weight of its significance. It's an amazing place. We here at EF continue to plan with hope for the future, and part of those plans is helping our teachers, students, and cadets travel to France to participate in the 80th anniversary of D-Day, which will be celebrated in 2024. You can find more information about the D-Day 80 experiences on our website. I'm afraid that's all the time we have today. We're just in the nick of time here. Before we leave, we'd love to thank our partners at the Juno Beach Center in both France and at home here in Canada for working so hard to put these videos together for us and to make sure that every one of you watching could feel transported to this great Women of the War exhibition, if only for a few minutes. Most importantly, thanks to you for watching and engaging with this part of our history. We hope you enjoyed it. If you'd like to see more of these experiences, let us know. Please share your feedback with us in the survey we send out. Thanks again. Have a great day. I hope everyone has a nice Remembrance Day tomorrow. Thanks so much. Bye.
We'll meet again. Don't know where. Don't know when. But I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you always do, till the blue skies drive the dark clouds far away. So will you please say hello to the folks that I know, tell them I won't be long. They'll be happy to know that as you saw me go, I was singing this song. We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.